Today on Land Beat, we're in Southwest Missouri and we want to talk to you a little bit about usable space. Usable space is a term that was coined three decades ago by a quail researcher in Oklahoma, Fred Guthrie.
Fred Guthrie, yeah.
But it doesn't just apply to quail.
No,
Usable space can be used for white-tailed deer, turkeys, anything. And what is usable space?
Well, usable space is this concept where you have all of the habitat structure, function, and needs that a wildlife species needs all in one place, right? So you don't have nesting over here, brood rearing over here, food over here, cover over here. It's all mixed up. It's a matrix of those habitat needs. And when usable space is fully maximized, then you can be assured that your wildlife population is going to be maximized or close to maximized when you have your entire management unit in usable space. And this is a landscape where usable space is pretty much fully maximized. This is a great example of usable space because all of the habitat needs of a bobwhite and a whole host of grassland species, even white-tailed deer and wild turkey in places, are met right here on this piece of ground.
Yeah, and usable space has a time component as well. Anything can be usable for certain periods of time. The key is we want it to be usable for the maximum amount of the year. So this prairie landscape, this grassland landscape, is a prime example for quail here behind us. Like you said, other animals as well. We have adequate nesting and brood rearing habitat scattered all across. We have woody escape cover that's important in summer and winter time. And you see that well distributed across the landscape. So all of this plays into the importance over time. Something else to consider, you know, these weeds that you see, these forbs, are providing brood habitat for quail. They're picking bugs all summer. But we have no food plots here.
No.
There's no row crop here. These are also providing winter food.
Right. Yeah, these forbs produce large seeded, they produce large seeds in the fall and winter time, and that's what these bobwhites are persisting on. This is one of the higher densities of bobwhites in this part of the state, and there's no row crops around. They're persisting solely on the native foods that they're finding out here, and that's one of the cool things about this usable space concept and this time concept. When you're thinking about food plots, if you're doing it in a conventional way where you're tilling it and you're waiting for your crops to grow, that's only usable for a few months a year. There's a large time component where that piece of ground, that acre, is not usable really for anything. When you're talking about managing on a native system like this, if you burn it, say, late March or late February, you only got a couple of months before it's back usable again if you get enough rain and it grows up.
Yeah, and lots of times, of course, we're not burning the whole thing. We're burning pieces. So we might lose a little usability for 30, 45 days, but then we're right back into the game. Some of our quail research showed that even nesting, we used to think that, you had to have an unburned unit
right.
for quail to nest. We get enough rainfall here in Southwest Missouri that we were having quail nesting in that year's burn units after July 1. All it took was enough vegetation height that they could tuck a nest under there.
Yeah.
So we really... managing under a native plant system with fire and grazing and other techniques, we're able to create usable space over almost every month, every day of the year.
Yeah, and that's the key to really maximizing the quail population on this area or maximizing wildlife populations anywhere around the country, is thinking about usable space. What components do they need year-round and making sure that that is well distributed across your landscape?